we're talking about selling, budgeting, and planning video projects, and those are really three different things. You know, it's easy to sell something, but you know, getting the, you know, making the sale or getting the interest is not the same as building out a specific budget that you can live and work with, and it's not the same as planning it. You know, there's of course implementation and the software and all those things that eventually come. But long before that, this is what often gets lumped into the pre-production stage of video. And this is where projects fail. And this is where most photographers fail because they're used to working completely independently. If you ask them what they make per hour, they don't really know because they don't actually track their time. And so we're going to discuss how all of these things sort of interconnect and how it's pretty much impossible to make video as a single person. But how you can collaborate either by working with peers or by hiring contractors for certain things that you might not be perfect at. One of the things that I've learned the hard way is do what you're good at and you will make far more money than doing things you're not good at. And there's always people that are good at those things that you're not. And so by focusing your skills, for many photographers, that's in a directing type role or a, you know, storyteller type role, the producer or the director role. That's great. You know, a lot of photographers are surprised to find out that on movies, you know, the director of photography may only shoot 10% of the actual movie. And between all of the other cameras that are rolling and all of the other things that are happening, they're not physically pushing the buttons. That doesn't change the fact that it's their artistic vision that maybe designed the project and lit the project and chose who those other key players were. But that's part of the process. All right, so my name's Rich Harrington. My company is Red Pixel. It's a visual communications company in DC. We focus primarily on producing visual content. That can range from public service announcements to marketing pieces to content for the web. I've been working on a handful of things, some web technology, which is called Picture. You're welcome to look that up. I do love photography. I took over publishing duties from Scott Bourne for Photo Focus. It's a free website that puts out content every day from a writing team of about 10 people. I don't know why the projector keeps flickering, but hopefully it'll stay on more or less. So that's what I do. The bulk of my photography is time-lapse photography, is what I get paid to do when I'm doing it for client work or elements that get worked into bigger pieces of the project. I do not try to sell or license my photography most of the time. It's usually part of a bigger piece. So I've been coming at it from the video model. What's it saying? Is it turned on? Yeah, it's turned on. It's plugged in. All right. We'll play the wiggle the cord game. The cord's awfully long, so I wonder if it just doesn't. Okay. We'll unplug it and replug it and see if it takes it. See, it holds up. So, and here we go. So, for me, photography is part of visual storytelling. And this is something that I often try to suggest to photographers to think about is stop defining yourself by your tool. So, you know, a plumber doesn't call himself a wrencher. You know, your job is to create and capture images that tell a story. Well, are you a storyteller? Now, we often define ourselves by tools to make it easier. When we're talking to peers, we might talk about that. But I see way too many people define themselves by their equipment. So I focus on where photography and video intersect. We do everything from stop motion type projects where we capture several stills or time-lapse type projects, traditional video, and photography serves a greater good in marketing pieces that we produce or capturing images of events that are used for fundraising purposes, things like that. So that's kind of where I come from. You're welcome to look us up. I just wanted to give you that background. The company is celebrating its 15th anniversary right now. So that's 15 years of being self-employed. It's moved from my basement into we just finally moved into our own building that we own. So, you know, it's been a good journey. Part of that and something I learned the hard way early on from good parenting was that if you truly want to make money, you need to be in charge. And what I mean by that is that you have to be leading the team. It's very hard. If the only time I make money is when I'm physically pushing buttons, that's incredibly limiting. because it means that every single vacation becomes not a vacation. So when you collaborate or you go into co-op type mode, it's riskier and you want to go into it gently. But that's part of the problem with video, is that it takes teams of 3 to 8 people to make a typical video. And a lot of people have a hard time with keeping control on that. All right, so jumping forward, I mentioned PhotoFocus. You're welcome to look at that. If you visit my personal website at Richard Harrington, you can click on resources. There's a bunch of articles and downloads. Help yourself. And if you're a lynda.com subscriber, there's a bunch of stuff up there on technical training if you want to learn that. A few things on business. On the video side, we produce all sorts of things from educational and web content. We work with universities and several publishers to produce educational content that's usually distributed on the internet, sometimes on TV. We produce a lot of public service announcements. We do a lot of motion graphics type work, which combines Photoshop and After Effects to take documentary type sources and bring them back to life. On the photo side, you know, some of my photography is purely for my own enjoyment. Some of it is commercial. I've done some work for Smithsonian, has been a client of ours, which has been a lot of fun. And my personal passions are travel and landscape and panoramic. And that's mainly because after spending all of this time working with end customers, I like to be what I call an antisocial photographer. For me, I don't like to talk to people when I'm making pictures. So I admire those of you who have that patience. All right, so let's talk about a little bit of positioning. One of the things I want to point out is that in my career, these are all job titles that I've had. You know, I've been a reporter. You know, school newspaper, was the editor of the high school paper, worked on the college one, worked at a broadcast news station where usually I was a director, directing newscast, calling all the camera shots, running the newscast. I did graphics. When I started, video editing systems cost $160,000. That same power is now on an iPad 20 years later. So, you know, huge, fascinating technology shifts. It used to just be that part of the problem was access to the equipment. I'm going to tell you, you know, I'm speccing out a studio right now. We're buying new cameras. They're $4,000 a pop for good studio cameras, where they used to be $40. And so access to the technology is no longer the barrier. And many people's careers started or were heavily benefited from the fact that they had an investment in equipment that other people can't afford. That barrier is gone. I've been a producer. I've been a publisher. A publisher's job is to coordinate the efforts of many others. So I am on my third website of publishing content and managing other people. That's a skill, just like a production manager or a writer. I blog and podcast. But what all of these things have in common when you break it down is they all have these same sorts of skills: telling stories, helping other people tell their stories, providing some level of entertainment so people keep watching. You know, even corporate videos that people supposedly have to watch, if they're boring, you don't get hired because the efficacy, the effectiveness of it goes dramatically down. So I routinely study entertainment. I've had a subscription to Entertainment Weekly, a magazine, since I was in college. And I keep up on trends in entertainment. I routinely go to movies I don't actually care about just to see editing style and pacing and the way that they're in. I watch TV shows that I don't like, not excessively, just once or twice to get through it to see, well, why is this so popular? And so you have to get outside of your own likes or dislikes and submerge yourself in pop culture, even if it's awful, just to see, why is this popular? What is it about this that is connecting with a certain audience? Otherwise, you are in business to make videos for people that are exactly like you. So you have to be able to relate to other people. You have to understand why reality TV is popular. You have to understand why people watch Dancing with the Stars. What is it? Well, it's the social component, the competitiveness, the voting. Half of it is wanting to see people that they recognize from before and maybe even, you know, at their expense. But there's all these different things that we connect. And so to me, it's all broken down to, it's my job to tell stories, to help other people tell their stories. I need to manage the process. I need to be, somebody has to be in charge. And as I put this together, the content has to both be accurate and entertaining. So all those things are really related. And if you stop defining yourself by your equipment, you'll probably see that you have a lot of the same skill set. So it's very easy to change mediums. I mentioned to you that I'm a certified PMP, project management professional. This is just tying the business practices of this together. I routinely think about things at a different level, at a process level. What I always say is I look for systemic problems. So within my company, part of the reason why we've survived is we try to address the problems that persist. Not that everything is unique, but that there's problems that are consistent. All right, let's jump into some of the specifics. One of the first things you have to determine is what you sell. And this is very simple. You need to actually be able to identify and break things into pretty much three categories. Things that you're going to do internally versus things you do externally, that's a big important decision. There are a lot of external services that I sell, but I have tight relationships with those external vendors. We routinely hire them for specific things. I know their cost. We have a great relationship. I see them as a partner. Make versus buy. I am amazed at the number of people who will not outsource a simple job. Like, here's a great example. We have a DVD burner and printer, and it's one of those robot machines that you load the discs up and the ink cartridges up, and you hit print, and it picks it up, it drops it in, it makes the copy, it prints it, spits it out. Well, we have that because sometimes clients call up with insane requests like, I need 100 DVDs for a presentation tomorrow. And we charge them a premium. But when a job comes in and the client wants 5,000, I can get those printed at like 79 cents a disc much faster going to an outside vendor and sell them at $2 a disc, where it costs me almost $2 a disc just to make one in-house. And so you have to realize that you can't have every capacity in-house, and you need to find vendors and partners that you trust so that you can offer a complete package of services. We can do short form closed captioning and open captions in-house now. Many clients require it. But the truth of the matter is that if it's more than a 10-minute job, the amount of time that it takes one of my employees, I'm paying them more than if I were to send the job out of house to a dedicated vendor who's going to be cheaper per dollar. Now, if you got an employee sitting around and you're looking for things to make them do, that's great. But I see people do things like have their staff go drive and pick up a client or go run errands going to the store when I know it's cheaper for me to tell a client to take Uber to the office or to send a cab. And so people often get very short-sighted with their money. And because video is a more expensive medium, be smart is what I'm trying to tell you. Another way that you determine your services is how people perceive you. So for example, we've done a lot of VR work, virtual tours, and there's not much demand for it. There wasn't much demand for time-lapse, but I still loved it and I still put it out there. And by putting it out there, it led to more work coming in. So you should have some flagship things that you feel passionate about. For us, it's educational content. We now have the largest book publisher, the largest online publisher, and several universities that come to our studios to produce educational content. 12 years ago, when I started producing online educational content and nobody was paying for it, but we did it to figure things out, we just did it because we knew eventually it would be important. So don't make every decision based on the work you have today. Make decisions based on the work you want in 2 or 3 years, sometimes choosing jobs or things to build your portfolio. When it comes to outsourcing, you have to be aware that, you know, you can do things locally, you can do them nationally, you can do them internationally. Some people have strong feelings about outsourcing. I have been outsourced myself. I lost a big client that was a $200,000 a year contract to an Irish company that had half of its funds subsidized by the Irish government. I wasn't happy. My client didn't like the work they were getting, but his boss was happy because it was less money. The truth of the matter is if I need things like transcription, the internet, there are tons of people outside of America who speak English very well. Many even better than people here. And you can send them an MP3 file of an interview and say, transcribe this. I need this turned into text for logging or notes. And it's far cheaper than me doing it in Washington, D.C. Do I still sometimes do it in Washington, D.C.? Yes. You know, so you're going to have to decide what your role is within your local community. What do you keep in market? There are certain things I hire in market to. But here's a good example of a national one. I do a lot of my gear rental from a company called lensrentals.com. You may have tried them. There's others out there. They're easy. If I'm traveling and I need something, they'll ship it to my hotel. It's great. I get grief from local rental houses of that I should be renting from them locally. And I'm like, fine, match their prices. We can't, but we're more convenient. We're right here. I'm like, I call them and it shows up the next day. For you, I have to drive over and pick it up. And it's twice as expensive. How is that more convenient? Well, if something goes wrong, you can drive over and get it from us. I said, well, if something goes wrong, I'll call you and you could charge me twice as much for the last minute job. But you know, that's a good example of where you have to make that decision. For me, it's just an economic reality. Other people that I work with will only rent locally. They strongly believe in supporting their local production community. And of course, with the partnering, how formal are you gonna get? You know, we have some formal partnerships where we have agreements for kickbacks on jobs, meaning like, okay, you're a producer, you bring in one of your clients, the client is yours. You know, if you were to leave us because of a disgruntled thing, you are free to leave. If the client decides to keep working with us, we're going to pay you this percentage. And, you know, we're going to pay you 8% off of everything we make that's profit back to you, you know, as for bringing in the work. We have other people that we simply just have payment terms in writing. So we know what they're going to get paid and we've agreed upon a rate in advance. Okay, we know what it's going to cost if we hire you for this next year. We've pre-negotiated your day rate. We know your payment terms. We know your overtime terms. These are all things you want to do. I will tell you, as you hire crews, I've seen people that we've hired bill us different rates every single time for the same work, because sometimes it depends on how they're feeling, their mood, where they're at, what the last person paid them. A lot of the freelancers you're going to hire are not going to be very good business people. My favorite is the other day, we had somebody that we paid 7 years ago come back and say, well, I never cashed the checks. And we looked and he didn't. And we're like, yes, but that's been closed for 7 years. Well, I moved offices and I never got the check. Could you still pay me? And we're like, yes, but not anytime soon. It's been 7 years, so we'll get around to it. But you know, it's like, it's amazing to me sometimes how far off they are. All right, next, bidding. So you're invited to bid on a project. One of the things that I always say is before you give the bid, make sure that you let somebody else look at it. In our office, every time we do a bid, somebody else has to review it before it goes out. We have a structure. This doesn't just mean anybody. In my company, there's four other people besides me who are authorized to do peer review on budgets and proposals. If you're just getting started and you're all by yourself, find a colleague, maybe in a different market. Maybe you have a friend that is in a totally different market. You don't compete against each other. Do peer review. Let them look at it. If you're really concerned about rates, just let them look at the time estimates and give you feedback. But I always forget things. You know, you will always forget to put a line item in or think about a charge. So this can be helpful. If I'm working with a strategic partner, like a director of photography, I'm doing a national commercial and I hire my friend Jim, who's a great DP who does all sorts of, you know, stuff for National Geographic. Okay, I've hired him to work on a job. I might send him over the budget and say, all right, I've allotted $4,000 for equipment rental for this project. You know, this is what I think we need. What do you think we need? And, you know, he may come back with $6,000. I say, look, I budgeted $4,000. What do we do? You know, and sometimes he's right and I have to make changes. Other times we compromise. But by contacting the person that you're working with and working with them and asking for their expertise, you can avoid problems. Sometimes people will be hiring us as a vendor and they'll just say, I've budgeted this much, is it realistic? You know, we'll get requests for budgets and I'll say, is this for an active project or for the future? And sometimes it's for the future and you will still do it. You'll do a budget estimate. The hardest thing that people struggle with is accurately estimating their time. And what the problem is here is that they don't know how much time it's going to take. So one of the things that I would challenge you to start doing is logging your time if you don't. There are tons of utilities and apps and things like this. Log like a lawyer, meaning in 15-minute increments. Even if you can't, at the end of the day or at lunchtime and when you shut down, make a basic time log. And we have our employees do the same thing. And what I have to emphasize to them is this is not because we don't trust you. This is so we can learn. Because these days, almost all projects are fixed price projects in the video world. getting time and materials is essentially gone. The only time I get time and materials is when it's an emergency or, you know, when the client has no idea what they want whatsoever. And even then there's pressure. Now, we'll talk about a fixed price project in a moment, but that doesn't mean that the price doesn't change. It means that if the scope of work doesn't change, the price doesn't change. People hear fixed price contract and they think it means slavery. That's not what it means. It means that you've pre-negotiated a price based on the work that's going to be performed. We'll talk more about that approach in a second. But time logs help. Keeping budgets help. There's all the time when a job comes up, we'll brainstorm. Oh, this sounds really similar to this other job we did. Let's look at what the budget was for that. And while we're doing projects, after the project, we also duplicate the first page of the budget, and the producer will go through and log expenses. Oh, this is how much we had down for crew. How much did we actually spend? This is what we had down for this service. What did it actually cost? So we can go back and learn as things have changed. And we started learning, for example, that, you know, we were undercharging for travel. One of the things that we've now done, for example, for travel is we say to clients, travel is billed at actual costs plus 5%. And, you know, we just said, you know, we'll agree to a meal per diem, not a problem. We simplified. We said, we're not submitting receipts for meals and expenses. Here's the flat day rate. We take the GSA day rate. Here it is. We will eat and live off of this. We're not going to have to be bothered to do the paperwork on submitting for expense reimbursement. But travel costs are actual costs plus 5%. If you don't want to pay the 5%, not a problem. You book the travel and put it on your credit card. Not a problem. And some people will do that, or they'll use their travel department or their corporate event to make the hotel reservations. The reason why I charge the 5% is because it's hitting my credit card. And if it's on my credit card for a month or two, I've paid that much in finance charges. So I'm passing that back to the client. It's little things like that that you learn the hard way. Shipping is another one where we learned we were spending a lot of money on shipping and we got rid of it by digital delivery almost across the board. So these are the things that by tracking expenses you learn. Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt, my name's Lee. Do we have access to this slideshow?
Yeah. Yep. Another thing that happens all the time is this formula. This is what the government uses to time estimate. One optimistic plus four most likely plus one pessimistic divided by six. When you don't know how long something takes, you ask people who are going to be doing the work. And the first number they give you is always the optimistic number. So if I said to you, 3D animators are the worst, by the way, but if you say to somebody, well, how long do you need to do this job? And then you say, well, how long would somebody else need? That's the most likely number. Every single creative person I've ever met underestimates their time. And if you think this is not true, how many times have you gotten in trouble with your significant other or spouse for being late? It just happens. And then you say, if things went wrong, you know, not like, you know, God clauses, like, you know, the earth opened up and swallowed the office. But if things were not quite where we thought, what would it be? So maybe it's something simple, like how long is it going to take to you know, photograph 20 product shots? And they say, oh, you know what? I can do that in an 8-hour day. Okay. How long would it take somebody else? Well, 10 hours. What would it take if, you know, the products were really scratched up? Some of them were reflective. We had to do extra lighting, you know, and tweak it. Some were matte. Oh, 16. All right. 1 times 8 is 8. 4 times 10 is 40. And 1 plus the pessimistic is 16. So that's 48, 54, 64. 64 divided by 6 is about 10.75 hours. You know, it's close to 11. And you know what? Statistically speaking, it's probably going to take 11 hours for that project to get done. And this is how they do time estimation all the time. It's just a survey method. Now, it sounds silly, but it gets over the human factor of time estimation. You really want to make it accurate? You ask a couple of people and it all adds up. So ultimately, we produce a line item budget for just about every project that we do. But on the left, you see the internal version, and on the right, you see the external version. Less than 5% of the time, provide line item pricing to my clients. I provide line item detail and I roll it up by category. But what I say to them is really, we're going to get down to the point of arguing, like, you're going to want to know what I charge you for expendables. People ask, what are expendables? I said, gaffer's tape, pearlescent, you know, paper to put in front of the lenses, stuff that gets worn out, used on shoots, that doesn't come back. Oh, well, why are you charging me for the P2 media fee? And this is an older budget, because we're not using tape. Well, it's tapeless media. That stuff lasts forever. No. Memory cards do wear out. We charge you $75 a shoot for memory cards. And what that means is, as our cards wear out or they need to get replaced with faster cards or higher capacity, we're always getting it. Okay. And I don't want to have that line item quibbling. So what I always say about budgeting is, give them enough detail so they know that you thought about their project. Oh, okay. They did break it all down, and this is what it costs. If they want to question or go deeper, sometimes we will. But I have found that 90% of the time when they want a line item budget, it's because they're doing a competitive bid and they're trying to compare apples to apples to prove to an internal decision maker that the vendor they've already selected is the right vendor. And they're just looking for information that they can use to prove that the other vendor is the best one. It's just not needed. I always say, give them enough information that they don't feel that they need to ask questions. More than that, you give them too much information, they're going to ask questions. So you'll notice that we trim away things to simplify. So on the left, these are not our current rates, but these are just some samples of what are we charging for things. On the right, this is what they'd see. And it helps them understand what went into the project. Okay? That'll help you out. We already talked about peer review. Always let your budgets get reviewed by somebody else before you show them to the client. And this can be people in different markets or strategic partners. Lastly, is that time tracking. You have to do time tracking. I recommend software. You can do this with apps on a phone. There are widgets that people can have on their desktop computers that are running. I would accept half-hour billing. Quarter-hour billing is the best. And so you just have to ask people to log what they were doing. And one of the things that you'll discover is that you may have to separate machine hours from people hours. In our office, there are two computers per person. Because in the world of video, there's this process called rendering that happens a lot. You start to do animation, you have to render it and generate it. You start to do exports for the web. For example, somebody wants you to make a Blu-ray disc, even on great fast computers, it's a 4-to-1 time ratio. An hour of material is going to take almost 4 hours to be prepared on a fast, high-end computer. So we have computers that are running, and each person pretty much has access to two machines. You may not get to that point, but we always figured out that people cost a lot more than technology. So we never sell our old computers. We just simply move them down the chain until they break. And so they get down converted. So I always have the best laptop. And because technically I don't. There's a couple that are higher end for some certain tasks. But, joking aside, things trickle down. So, we've got a couple of high-end HP, Z840 workstations that are dual 12-core machines with 64 gigs of RAM, 6 gigabyte graphics cards, scream at animation. Well, a producer who's just simply working on scripts may have a laptop that's 5 years old, because word processing is very different than exporting video files for the web. But both computers still turn on, so it's okay. They just move down the chain. And so always evaluate that. I know a lot of people who get caught up with selling their old equipment. I still have my D300s. And when I have a time-lapse job come up, they're one more body that I can set up and let run. And they still make a perfectly fine image for that. It's not what I'm using bulk of the day, but it still has purpose. And I can tell you there's been times that we've pulled out old equipment because we've had 3 jobs running at once, and it's good to have it on the shelf. It's worth more to me than the $400 I would get in trade for it. So think about that. All right, any questions on that section of sort of the pre-stuff? We're going to get into budgeting specifics more in a moment.
What is your favorite time tracking software?
We use Basecamp, which is an online project management system. And they do that. And then we have been using all my employees have different apps, actually. I just let them choose their own.
Yeah.
For me, I just keep a basic log on. I just simply do it into the Excels for the project files. I just put it right back into the Excel documents, but it doesn't matter. There's a lot.
Other one, getting back to externally contracted products and services.
Yeah.
I'm not at a large production house. My mm-hmm. clients know that I don't, you know, print all of their promotion materials yeah. on my inkjet.
Yeah.
What do you say when they ask you how much you're paying for these?
So I think what the question is there is, you know, they ultimately want to know what you're marking up.
Yeah.
My take on things when I outsource is oftentimes I'm very transparent. So, for example, if I'm sending something to a replicator for DVDs, ask yourself this. Is it in your best interest to put that on your credit card or to carry that debt? I mean, my tax bills and business license are set based on my revenue. Mm-hmm. I may charge my client a fee, of course, to build the DVD, manage it, replicate it, and then we'll charge a management fee. Oh, you know, we're charging you $450 to manage the process of getting these manufactured. This will include quality control, coordinating with the vendor and everything else, and the vendor is going to direct bill you. I've just turned that on their head because every one of our vendors now advertises to clients. Clients can figure out who you're printing with.
Yeah.
And they can hire those people for the same price. It used to be that printers would have different rates for general public versus when a design house comes. That's gone. So I don't play that game anymore. I don't mark it up. I have them direct pay for those outside services and just charge a management fee for our time for the management of the process. Consider that as a possible option. Okay. Otherwise, it gets tough. There are certain things that we have to mark up. Typically, our markups are in the 20% range for things, but I find it much easier to just charge a management fee than a markup fee. Nobody questions a management fee. They always question markup. Does that make sense to you guys? Okay. Anything else before we go forward? All right. Let's talk about the actual budgeting process. And one of the first things I always point out is this concept called triple constraint. This is pretty simple, and it basically says there's three things that drive a project. The scope of work, which is what has to get done, the schedule, and the budget. These three things are interconnected. Now, we often jokingly call this, you know, good, fast, cheap, pick two, but that doesn't work because clients never want to pick two. And you also still have to do quality work. So what it comes down to is balancing this out. So if the schedule is super tight and the budget is tight, I'm going to have to say we're going to need to take a simpler approach. If the scope is enormous and the schedule is tight, I have to charge more for the budget. I got contacted on Sunday by NASA wanting to do a webcast on Monday. They're like, we need a bid and we have to get this approved tonight and for tomorrow. And my simple response was, it's Sunday at 4 o'clock and you need this tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. for a setup. Let's try this the other way. How much money do you have? And I'll tell you if I can show up or not, because there's nothing about this job that's going to be pleasurable, enjoyable, or easy. And not that that's the definition of work, but it was a disaster. It was going to be a disaster no matter what. Nobody took the job. It's things like that where you have to find that balance. These three things, it's impossible to say, I want a bunch of work done, I need it tomorrow, and I have no money. We do have clients, like some of our nonprofits, who need great work done, and they don't have a big budget. And I'm able to fit their work in between other stuff and charge them less of a rate. And I'm also able to say, we need longer ramp times for that. Same with some of our pro bono work. We've done some pro bono work for groups, and it's fine when I've got a 6-month window. When they come back and need something for next week or even a month from now, I'm like, I'm sorry, I can't help you. We don't have the time. So you have to balance that stuff out. This is a simple control cycle, and we'll talk about a more elaborate one a little bit later, but this is standard project management. You start a job and you set the objective. You then start to work. And then you compare your progress and you say, okay, is the work good? Does it meet the quality control results that we've set? No? Okay, fix it. Yes, great. Have we finished everything we said we're going to do? No, keep working. Yes, you're done. Now, this is a gross simplification, but I can tell you many creative professionals don't set objectives that are attainable. We're going to create a inspirational and motivating video that is compelling and going to drive engagement. Well, is the project done until they've then used it for 6 months and can measure if they got a financial return on fundraising? Did you actually drive engagement? Are you going to be doing the monitoring and the web traffic to prove that? If you are, then you have to spread that cycle out and split that out into something else. But you know, I don't use flowery language when describing objectives. I don't say we're going to deliver a 4 to 8 minute video, because an 8 minute video should cost twice as much as a 4 minute video. Why? Because it's twice as long. You know, I could say we're going to provide a 2.5 to 3.5 minute video that contains interviews shot on 3 days. Those interviews are going to be, you know, by client at a client provided location. You know, and I can be very specific of what's included. That's great. Specificity is awesome. Generic is not. And you have to be able to define what it is when it's done. So did you commit to delivering, you know, 3 copies of the piece? I see people don't specify what the end deliverable is. We're going to say, oh, we're going to provide you 2 digital compressions, 2 different formats, plus 1 archive format on a disk that you can back up. We don't promise them their raw footage. We don't promise them their project files. If they ask for that, we charge them for it. We typically don't hand off our project files. We liken them to blueprints. Our clients technically, in many cases, own their raw footage. Most of the video industry is built upon the concept of work for hire, where the producer is the copyright holder. You can thank Mr. Sonny Bono and Walt Disney Company for all of the revisions to the Copyright Act, but video is seen as a collaborative element. So when I hire crew people to shoot for me, I don't have to negotiate the rights from the videographer. They're not licensing me the footage. It's work for hire, because it's part of a collaborative project that involves writers and art directors and producers and everything else. If your model is built upon licensing, you need a new model for video. Time-lapse work, I can license. Stock footage, you can license. Everything else is pretty much treated as work for hire. You need to get paid up front. And we'll talk about those models later, but you need to realize that you are one piece of a much bigger puzzle. If you are producing the content yourself, you may be the copyright holder. About half of what we produce, we do hold copyright on, because we're producing finished pieces that we're licensing the finished pieces to other folks. But if the client is covering all of the costs, they are technically, legally, the producer. The producer is the one who holds the purse strings. So unless you're self-funding the production, you are not the copyright holder in the world of video. Okay. Now, you are free to try to change that. You are free to write your own contract. You are free to get whatever terms you want. I have seen worse terms where people have even tried to take away our moral rights to work, where we're not allowed to even show the work. I understand when work contains sensitive internal information, just like you may, let's say you're hired to shoot a brand new car, you probably better not be posting that to social media or on your blog before the product comes out. We get those sorts of things, right? If you ever want to work again, don't be stupid. But at the same time, you have to be very careful and realize that going in, every video contract you get is going to be written very differently than photo contracts you've gotten. So you're going to have to come to terms with most of that. And you're going to have to decide what's important to you. The video industry is not built upon a royalty model. So you can make more money. You just can't be thinking that there's going to be a long-term gain. Now, we often try to put in that we own the footage. And we've successfully done that in many cases, meaning that I can take stuff that's not proprietary and license it. And I also will say things like, okay, if we are on location or traveling for you, we are free to also shoot our own footage that is for us, and we retain rights. You get hired by Discovery Channel, every single thing you shoot, even if you pulled out your iPhone when you are working for them, is 100% theirs. Everything. And you maintain no rights to it, even to keep your own copy. So always read your contracts. Everybody good with that? and decide your morality versus your business ethics versus your need to make a living, and find a comfortable balance between the three. All right, you scope the project. This is a simple document. You can see the outline on the right. When you download the slides, you can see this. But we do this for pretty much every project that has more than a budget of about $5,000. And what it comes down to is making sure, for example, that it has a name, that the name you call it is the same name that the client calls it, so when you send in the invoice, it gets paid. Sounds silly, but I see this happen all the time. Make sure that you get a purchase order and that it's a unique name. You write an executive summary. The executive summary is what an executive would read so they could decide whether or not to kill the project and how important it is. This is a half page to one page description of what's to be done and why it's important. If you don't include this, you may find your project getting killed. You then define the scope. What exactly are you doing? And you spell these things out. So the name, the summary, a little bit about why. Spell out the scope. What is it you're doing? The objectives, the deliverables, etc. Identify the key people and then get it signed. This saves us all the time. We do this on every project. You could do this on photography projects. A simple scoping statement says exactly what you're going to do. And because the client signs it, it becomes binding. Very easy, very straightforward. A clear definition of the work to be done and who's in charge. I have been able to successfully bill clients more because all of a sudden additional approval people start popping up. You said that this video had two rounds of review and that you had sign-off authority. Well, now your boss looked at the video and has just undone the graphics that you previously approved and decided that we needed to shoot three more interviews. Of course you have to pay. This is not a fixed price. This was the scope of work. This was what was supposed to happen. You changed it. Here's the new charge. And so it's important that you spell all that stuff out. Not in a confrontational way. Just in a this is what I'm doing sort of way. This is what it costs. Many people take the Bonsop approach to budgeting, back of napkin, seat of pants. They simply look at what they think they need to make that month, and that's what they try to get out of a client. How much do I need to pay my bills? How much is on my credit cards? I have discovered that sometimes work is too expensive to take the job, that the amount of effort it's going to take to do the project and the amount I have to outsource means that it's a bad job for me, that I'm going to lose money or barely come out ahead. So I will choose not to take the job. Don't be so hard up for work that you take jobs just to be working. There is a cost in doing work for you too, and you have to know that. And then of course, get the contract. How often are you guys signing contracts with your clients now? Half the time, all the time, some of the time?
Every time.
Every time is great. Sometimes we have a simple agreement letter that doesn't say contract so that it doesn't have to go through legal review. It's still a contract. So if you spell things out, you can write things that function as contracts that don't read like legalese. You should also have a standard rider that if they send over their contract, you say, that's fine, but this attachment, these are my standard terms and it needs to become an attachment to yours and it must be used. All right. When you get a video job, do what we call a work breakdown structure. This is where you split it up into the tasks. So you're asked to make a DVD. So in this case, America Online said to us, we need a demo reel to play at conferences and hand out. Okay. All the videos are already done. Great. So the video had to be captured, taken from tapes and different sources and pulled in. They wanted to have consistent audio. They wanted them to match sort of color, and we had to make the video files, MPEG-2 for the DVD. They wanted a menu. Okay. We decided there's going to be static menus. Those menus had to be designed, had to be written, had to be mocked up. Great. There was packaging. The discs had to be made. They had to be put together. They had to be shipped. And somebody, and this is the place that everybody always forgets to charge, somebody had to be in charge of the project. Who answers the phone? Who talks to the client? Who makes sure that everything came in? Well, when you break down and they say, how much does it cost to make a DVD? I don't know. Oh, well, how many video assets are there? Oh, there's 14 clips. Okay. I can tell you how long it's going to take to capture those and encode. How many video assets are there? Oh, okay. Well, how many menus do we need? And as you start to get more specifics on each of these, it's very easy to come up with a cost. Another way of thinking of this is when someone says, how much does it cost to throw a dinner party? I don't know. What are we going to serve? Oh, let's figure out, oh, we're going to do a barbecue. It's going to be hamburgers and hot dogs and a bunch of salads and some fruit and beer. Okay, that's very different than a formal dinner party with really good wine. So you have to be able to define the what before you can say how much. Don't go crazy with this. Sometimes I'll try to get clients to give me a ballpark or a not to exceed budget so I can suggest things that fit. Many clients will fight me on giving me that number, and I say, look, have you ever gone car shopping? Yes. When you go car shopping, do you have a budget that you don't want to go over? Yes. Same thing here. Have you ever called up a realtor and said, show me some houses? They're going to ask you, are you looking for a mansion? Are you looking for a one-bedroom studio? You have to be able to give me some basic parameters. I make the commitment when they tell me their not-to-exceed number that I will deliver one budget that's below, one that matches, and one that goes above so they can see what they can get, some other recommendations for stuff that costs more. Okay, you can't afford a makeup artist for your budget with this sort of thing, but I'm going to suggest, since this contains, you know, key members of the CEO and key members of the company, that having a makeup artist would go a long way. You know, this is what it costs, and I spell that out as a line item so they can decide to add it or not. Does that make sense? If you get them to tell you, and people take this confrontationally, like if I tell you my number, you're just going to take advantage of me. No. If I commit that I'm going to give you a budget that's below, one that matches, and one that gives you some extra options, and I promise to give you a line item budget that breaks out the key elements, then all of a sudden they realize that you are trying to work with them as a consultant, not take advantage of them. This is a key thing on projects like this. Otherwise, it just causes problems. If they refuse, I have two answers. One, my next question is how many people are bidding on this job? If it's more than three, I usually pass. If it's close to that, I'll say, how did you hear about us if it's not an existing client? Oh, you were referred to by so-and-so. Okay. Did they tell you I was cheap? No. Did they tell you I was good? Yes. Okay. So where do you want to go? And I just take it right to the head. I said, I have gotten things. Oh, they told me you were fair. Good. I'm fair with my pricing. You get what you pay for. Not a problem. And I'm always transparent. So I don't hide my pricing. I let clients know how we get there. But these are the things that you have to determine. Another thing is I'll say, well, what's the deciding factor? Is price the number one deciding factor? If it is, I almost never want the job because there's always somebody who will work cheaper than you. Always. Those are the companies that go out of business every 2 to 3 years, and then they go back and take a staff job, and then they get frustrated 2 to 3 years later, and they quit, and they go freelance, and then they take a staff job, and they're in a vicious cycle. These are the people that work out of their houses. It's okay to work out of your house, but they don't carry business licenses. They don't carry insurance. They don't properly pay their taxes. You can't compete with that. If you need to do this, you can do these work breakdown structures in OmniGraffle. You can do this in PowerPoint. You can do this in Microsoft Office. Just look for a feature called Organizational Chart Maker, and it's a nice visual way for you to break down a project so it makes sense. All right. I try to avoid doing full-blown proposals. I always try to just do simple responses. If we have to do a proposal, I've got a library of things. One of the best things I tell you is to gather behind-the-scenes photos from your projects. We almost always have these from every job. We shoot them at our own expense. We gather them up. We will make sure to stage a few things because nothing helps a proposal these days like photographic proof that you know how to do a job. Testimonials and photos of you working are the best way to sell your services. I learned this from working on infomercials, that when people see, seeing is believing. So a proposal, I can say lots of things in a proposal, but if I show a great behind the scenes couple of shots from some of the commercials we've worked on, and they see all the things that go into that, they know we know what we're doing, that we've done it before. So there is proof. always ask yourself simple questions when you're trying to put the bid out there. You know, what is it that you're trying to accomplish? I always try to tear it down, and if we don't understand, I'll reach out to the client to make sure I fully understand what the objectives are. And of course, you just read through the requests. Those will help you. All right, let's go forward just a little bit. Fixed price contracts. Fixed price contracts are pretty much standard these days for video. Have you guys ever done a fixed price contract before? Are you familiar with the concept? Okay. So a fixed price contract protects both sides. It simply says this is what it costs. So let's go back to that catering example. I agree to deliver a barbecue lunch for 50 employees at your company. It will be delivered on a weekday between the hours of 11:30 and 1. Each person can have two sandwiches. We will also bring an assortment of soft drinks, several different types of chips, and a platter of dessert bars and cookies. I've pretty much protected myself there, right? So if the client calls up and says, oh, it's on a Sunday, Sunday costs more. We're not open on Sundays. We're a business catering company. We don't work on the weekends. We have commitments. I have to bring in more people to the weekends. I have to pay overtime. It costs you more. Oh, you want to serve steak? Well, we committed to hamburgers and hot dogs and barbecue pork sandwiches. That was spelled out. Oh, all of your employees are football players. They eat four sandwiches. Okay, well, fine. We just need to double the budget. We can do that. You know, by spelling it out, it's very clear. Now, they know, and it doesn't matter that, oh, you got triple booked that day and you had to hire some outside contractors. That's your fault, not theirs. Oh, the new cook you hired burned everything the first time. You had to throw it all out and start over again. That's not their fault, it's yours. Do you see how it can protect both sides? Now, people understand food analogies, but it's the same with video, it's the same with photography. You say what you're going to do, you do what you said you were going to do, and then you get paid for what you did. That's the gross simplification. So if you clearly define the scope of work, then it's very easy to get paid for it. And you provide coverage. So on the shoot thing, we might say things like, oh, a production day is an 8-hour day, portal to portal. We usually do 10-hour days, portal to portal, meaning from when we leave the office to when we return. Oh, you've scheduled so many things in here that it's going to take a 14-hour shoot day? Not a problem. I once had a 28-hour shoot day for a piece that was an emergency piece of corporate communication. It was budgeted an 8-hour day. I had to say to the crew and to the client, you know, this is what each additional hour costs up to hour 12. We're at time and a half. Okay, now we're at double time. We're now on hour 26, and for the record, this is at triple rate. You understand this, right? And they kept signing off on the piece of paper. It was insane. But I had to allow the crew to leave who had to leave, and we had to get some emergency people to come in. You know, it was an insane day. But it was very clear. We didn't say, oh, it's a shoot day or a shoot, because we would have been hosed. You have to define what is that. How many cameras are you showing up with? How many crew people are you showing up with? We've had instances where things have blown up and we've had to scale up and they just paid for it. But if you don't define it, you don't want to argue about it after the fact. So we'll say things like, oh, this includes a director, a videographer, an audio engineer, and a production assistant. Makeup artist, this much per day. Teleprompter operator, this much per day. Does that make sense? We've even had to go as far as explain that an 8-hour day is a continuous 8-hour day. We've had people say, oh, well, I need you to come in the morning, and the CEO has got a busy day, so we need you ready to go at 7 a.m., but then I'd like you to stay for the board meeting that night. So we have to get there at 5 a.m., and we go home at 10 at night? Sure, not a problem. That is a 15-hour day. Oh, no, I only need you for 8 hours. I can sell you two half crews, and a half crew is not the same price as half. There's no such thing as a half day. A half day is 0.75 of your full day rate. Just so you know that. Never charge a half day rate at half rate, because you can't do any more work that day. other than you can catch up on your billing or turn your dry cleaning in or maybe pick up your kids from school early, but you're shot for the day. You cannot double book yourself on a day. So by keeping those time records and tracking what you're doing, it becomes pretty easy to just explain to people, this is what we did, this is how much it cost, here you go. If you provide updates along the way, then there's less confusion. So when we're doing a complex project, we'll let them know as they start to approach milestones. Hey, we had budgeted 24 hours for the design stage, and we're on round 7 of the design. Just so you know, we've already used up 80% of the design budget. We can keep designing, but we're going to go over budget on this line item. Hey, you wanted to add another shoot day. Not a problem. Here's the cost. Please respond back to this email authorizing this change. Those are just called change orders. So you had asked, how do we keep them from making changes? Don't keep them from making changes. Just make sure that as they make changes, they know that it costs money. And sometimes it benefits them. They cancel a shoot day. Okay, do they get all the money back? It depends. If they cancel 4 weeks out, sure. If they cancel a week out, my response might be, well, I need to cancel all of my vendors and myself. Let me see what I can do. Sometimes my vendors will be fine with it. Most of mine, we have a good relationship. 72 hours, they're not going to charge me if I cancel. If I abuse that, you know, usually they make it up on the other side. Oh, you canceled the night before. You're paying for it one way or the other. Would you like me to come over and wash your car? It'll be expensive, but you got my time. You know, oh, they cancel 3 weeks in advance, but you booked travel a month ago. Well, you got to pay the travel costs. Or would you prefer that I bought refundable tickets for 4 times the rate? I can do that. Do you see what I'm saying? You just have to be honest with folks. If the change benefits them, let some money go back to them. If the change needs to cost them some money, it's fine. If every change order only ends up in you making more money, your clients will become very distrustful of you. If change orders literally just affect the budget and you're honest about it, they're not going to really question your ethics and you'll be fine. Okay? All right. Let's do a budget really quick and then we'll go on to a few more things. So let's just say, give me a fictitious scenario on a relatively simple project that maybe you had to do before or that you've been asked about. I could throw one out if we're feeling tired.
10 set 15 minute educational videos deliverable digitally.
Okay, so I'm going to simplify that just a little bit so it doesn't make people's numbers heads hurt. But let's say they want to produce, they want you to take a college professor who gives lectures and they want you to produce, you know, 8 modules that are about 15 minutes long. We're fine. And we've clarified, okay, this means just digital files only, not tape backup or anything else. Okay, so real simple. Let me just make this a little larger so you can see it. You know, we try to pretty much always charge something for creative design. What's creative design? Creative design is getting the whole team together to have the project meeting to talk through everything. So that's basically the staff meeting to kick it all off and to make sure that everybody understands the job and that we brainstorm. I don't charge for everybody's time in the room. I just charge a simple fee. Producer. Well, the producer puts all of the things together. So we're going to assume that this is one professor in one location, just for simplicity. Okay. And this person has never been on camera before. They're going to need some extra hand-holding. We're going to have to discuss wardrobe with them. They're a little bit nervous. I'm going to put in 6 hours. Our production coordinator is going to make sure that everything is lined up. It might be the same person, but they're going to make sure that we have our permits and that we know where we're going and where the shoot's going to happen. Since it's only one location, it may only take them 4 hours. And the production assistant is the one who packs up all the gear. 4 hours for this type of job. Half day to pack up the gear and unpack the gear. Basically, for a shoot, I charge 2 hours to get the gear packed up and 2 hours to put it away. These might be things you don't actually charge for. You guys might be forgetting to charge for that time, but I charge for everything that's associated with that project. If I didn't have this job, would I have to pack up the equipment and take it out of the office? No. I have clients who go, so how do I not pay that? So come to my studio and shoot here. It's easy. Like, clients are like, it's cheaper to shoot in your studios than for you to come to the thing that I own? Yes, because you bring one person to me and I've got to bring eight people to you. Of course it's cheaper for you to come to me. Something to think about if you have space. Location scout. Do you have to go on site? Well, we've never shot at this location before, so we'll typically charge for half a day to go on site and look at it. And we always charge for office expenses. This is like paper, ink, telephones. And there is going to be no shipping because we're just doing digital delivery. Okay, there's my pre-production number. Do you see the logic here? It's just sort of thinking it through. All right, they think we can do everything in one shoot day. They're adamant that this person knows their stuff. They teach this all the time. It's going to be one shoot day. So we determine that we're going to have a director. We're not going to have a producer because there's not a lot of complexities. We don't have to move from location to location. We're only managing one thing. But I'm going to bring an assistant producer just to help keep all the things on schedule and to be in charge of things like craft services and lunch and permits. And when something goes wrong or someone's lost, to handle the details. There's no art director. There's no director of photography. It's not a high-end piece. There's one videographer to run the camera. There's one audio person to run audio. One of the biggest mistakes that most photographers make is that they don't separate the recording of audio from the recording of video. Not necessarily to two different devices, just good sound is half the picture, and it's very hard to be making good pictures and good audio at the same point. You are splitting your attention in too many different ways. And imagine that you also are now worried about the person's performance. One of the things I see a whole bunch of times is that photographers make terrible interviewers because they're so focused on their camera and the quality of the video that the audio suffers and the content suffers even more. When I'm shooting, I am almost never behind the camera, even though I am perfectly capable of running the camera. Why? Because I'm a fantastic interviewer. And with all of my skills as a journalist and connecting with the subject and making them feel comfortable and open up, we get fantastic performances out of our interviews. We really get people engaged. They love us. They compliment. Wow, I've been on camera before. I was just so nervous. With you, I felt so comfortable. You made it so easy. Wow, we got all this great content. Do you know what always happens for me? We're able to squeeze in tons more interview questions and get stuff that we turn into more projects later with them. Like I always ask them, like, if there was time, do you have anything else coming up in the pike that you'd love to get some things in the can for? Oh yeah, we're gonna be launching this other new product, but it's a couple months away, but it'd be great if when you talk to our engineer, you can ask him about these couple of points. Oh sure, let's just get that in the can and we can use it later. Thinking ahead, your client, you're thinking, oh, I lost a shoot. No, you didn't. Do you wanna know where you're gonna make your most money in video? Post-production. For every one day of shooting, there's 5 days of post-production, the actual editing. Your shoots are not your profit center. You will make money off of pre-production, which is the script writing and the creative design, and post-production. Shooting, you break even or make a small profit on, most times. I know that may sound depressing as a photographer, but just realize it's all the other stuff where the profit centers are. And to be perfectly honest, it's nice to sometimes just be able to work from home, billing $150 an hour for pushing buttons on a keyboard, okay? All right, so one audio engineer, yes, they needed a teleprompter. No, they didn't want any makeup artist. We had a basic camera package. There we go. We had a basic lighting package, just a simple interview lighting kit. We had a basic interview microphone package. We charged for the tapeless media and the expendables. We had a budget for lunch and craft services. We provided food. And we charged, transportation is one of those things where we had to assess like how much parking, how many vehicles. But let's just say there was only two vehicles, parking was $40 a day. We charged for fuel, it was $175. All right. There's our shoot budget. We come back, okay. How heavy-handed is the client? How many rounds of review? Okay, 16 hours of producer time. It's going to be somebody to load everything one day to get all that material into the computer and organized. They want to produce those 15-minute videos. Well, it depends. How complex is it? Oh, it's just the person talking plus take out their mistakes and intercut their slides and some photos they gave us. All right, 15-minute video, 8-to-1 ratio, 2 hours for each video. That's fine. 8 videos. Let's try 16 hours for the initial edit. Plus, we'll put in another 4 for pad, so 20 hours. These are the metrics that you start to use, and you can build this comfort level. I'm simplifying it, but it's just when you break it down, you start to accommodate. Oh, is there any graphics? Yeah, we're going to enhance some graphics. We've allotted an hour per video for graphics, plus 4 hours for the initial design to make their template. All right, that's all great. There is no voiceover. We're not doing any fancy thing with the audio. We're going to get this thing exported to the web. They've got 8 videos at 15 minutes each, so that's 120 minutes per compression, 120 minutes for the second format. We've budgeted for stock music, non-broadcast. We're going to do a single buyout cut that gets used as a bumper on all things. That's great. We charge for storage. We charge for the hard drives we use. And we also charge to archive everything, so that we do a backup. We charge to archive, but we don't promise an archive. All we promise to back up is the finished product. And we back up that finished product multiple locations. We use LTO tape. It's great for archiving. It's what banks use. If you have hard drives sitting on a shelf and you don't keep them powered up, they will start to lose data within 6 months. Hard drives on a shelf without power demagnetize. Hard drives plugged in spinning are just like tires. They eventually blow out. So we use Drobos for near-term storage, so that if one drive fails, no big deal. I've got an 8-bay Drobo, 2 drives can fail, I don't lose anything. If a drive fails, it turns red, I put in a replacement, it's fine. For stuff that we are archiving that we don't need on hand, we back it up to 2 LTO tapes. One stays in the office, one goes off-site. They have a 20-year shelf life. If I'm in business 20 years from now, it's a problem. So I don't promise to keep things for my client. We will give them a copy and make it their problem. So that's your call. But if you're going to be in the archive business, that's a pretty expensive business to be in. It's also gotten really cheap with Amazon storage to start archiving your clients' files, not all of their raw assets, but the finished projects to the cloud. So S3, like deep storage on there, where you're not paying for bandwidth, you're just paying a very small fee to upload it. Very cheap way to archive stuff long term.
Okay. And that was Amazon what?
Just look at some of the Amazon options, like under S3, but they've got a lot of very cheap stuff where you pay a low fee for just storage. It's where a lot of photographers are archiving their photos as well. It's only when you start getting into bandwidth that it gets expensive. It's not expensive to park it on a server.
But it's really expensive to retrieve the information once it's out there, right?
Not really expensive. You know, the sort of thing where it's cheaper than paying for data recovery. Yeah, but it's not bad. I mean, you're not going to want to say to the client, oh, pull it down whenever you want. It's your copy, and you pull it down. So, but we don't usually have to pull things down. That's like backup number 4. Okay? All right. And we're not doing any 508 compliance. So there's a price. And it's just that sort of logic. And then I would say to the client, oh, look, you know, you're doing 8 videos. This is the breakdown in cost per video. You know, so they sort of get an idea on what they're paying. Now, there's lots of ways of doing this. There's lots of things that can make that more or less accurate. But that's the simplicity of what you're pretty much doing, is you just need to be able to spell out the work and then break it down. Questions on what I did there? It comes down to having hourly rates and being able to estimate the things. Now, you can download a budget template off my website. There are tons of other budget templates out there, but you have to decide what your time is worth. And when I'm writing a script, I'm worth about $250 an hour. When I am, you know, running to the store to buy props for a shoot, I'm worth about $45 an hour, which is why I'm not charging the same rate for my time. If I'm doing stuff that's strategic communications, I may be billing $500 an hour. I'm charging a lot less for, you know, backing up data. Usually, in my case, somebody else is doing that. But when I started my company, it wasn't. You know, we're at about a 10-person company now. I usually don't do things I don't like anymore. I still sometimes have to take out the trash. The other day, I had to demonstrate to my employees what a wet vac was and how it takes up an espresso off the floor, and they too could do it. It was good for them to see that they understand that this has to happen. But, you know, I still run to the store and run errands and still need to pick things up, and I still like to shop for things, and I'll still do some of the menial tasks. So I enjoy it. But you have to realize that different skills are worth different money. And so you should assign an hourly rate to services. And then what I always say to folks is, when you're struggling, when you first start out your business, if you've never hired somebody else before, make a list of all the things you do in a week that you don't want to do or that you don't have to do. And if it adds up to 20 hours of time, hire a recent college graduate at a reasonable salary and bring them on board and let them go. It'll take them 40 hours to do what took you 20, and you have 20 more hours to sell your business. You have 20 more hours to meet with existing clients and grow your business. Seriously, I have done this time and time again, and we've just repeated the same model. Every one of my employees, save maybe five, were people that we hired fresh out of school and we developed, and they would be with us for a while. Others are key people that are partners that I worked with before, people I worked with at past jobs. But I've always been a big believer that you can take things off of your plate and put them onto someone else's plate so you can do what only you can do, which is sell your business and meet with your important clients to deepen the relationship. If you are doing things like, you know, running out to buy craft services for the shoot, and that's, you know, and the choice is you doing that versus you getting on set an hour earlier so you can get FaceTime with the client so you can deepen your relationship, hire a production assistant for $150 a day and get that extra hour with the client where they're your captive and you can build the relationship. Does that make sense to everyone? All right. Payment terms. A lot of people struggle on this. Basically, there's different methods. Period-based is great if you're an employer. Okay for freelancers on a very long-term assignment, but you need to make sure that if you're doing this, you get all of your W-9 and tax information turned in right away. So I always have my W-9 on all of my devices so I can send it. You should have it on your phone. You can save the PDF to your ebook program on your phone, or there's lots of other things. So as soon as you're hired for the job, send in the W-9, and then I usually follow that up immediately with an invoice for something. Oh, there was 1 hour of consultation time. I send that in. Do you know why I send in an invoice immediately? One, you get an idea how long they take to pay. Two, you can actually see all of the hurdles and the problems. Oh, you're not on our approved vendor list. You need to fill out these six pieces of paperwork. Oh, I don't have this piece of missing information. Oh, you don't have the correct purchase order on your invoice. It got kicked back. There's all sorts of crap that comes up with, some of it legitimate, some of it totally manufactured. So get that out of the way on an invoice you don't actually care about early on. Get it through the process. If you're doing small stuff, you're a contractor, you're being hired to run a camera on set for a client. A lot of times I get people who want me to pay immediately. If it's an in-town person that I work with regularly, they'll normally bill me and give me the 30 days and they don't care. But if I'm hiring somebody because I'm going into another market and we've never worked together, it's expected that I pay at the time that they show up. So at the end of the day, they want to be paid. This is not unheard of. You can do this yourself if you're doing this type of work by just, are you guys familiar with Square or QuickBooks Payments? Get the little thing, plug into your phone, swipe, take the credit card. For me, I just use bill.com, which is tied into QuickBooks. I could send an invoice immediately right there. They can make the online payment, and I can just send them an invoice from my iPad. It shows up on their phone. They click the link, enter their credit card, and hit pay. I pay less of a fee. Doesn't matter. Find something that works for you, but realize that if you're doing single day type jobs or gear rental, just bill it when it happens. Don't say, oh yeah, take my gear on a shoot and I'll invoice you and you can pay me weeks from now. Get paid then, okay? Very simple. End of month is only good if you're doing really long-term jobs. You have to be very accurate with your time tracking And I recommend not doing this method. The strongest thing that I say is progress payments. Make sure that as you achieve milestones, you get paid. So if it's a shoot, maybe it's a 55% deposit up front, and then 45% is billed due net 30 after the shoot. You paid 55% before the shoot, you're a regular client, you paid the booking fee, then I billed you after the project was done. Oh, we're doing editing and post, not a problem. 40% up front, 35% is due after the shoot, 25% is due net 30 after we deliver the approval copy. Not the final video, the final approval copy. Because I've seen videos sit in review for months. I always say, that's fine. You have this piece of paper that allows for 4 more hours of any tweaks or things that you catch, but this was your final copy. You did the rough cut review, you did the fine cut review, we incorporated all of your changes, not a problem. Here's your final video, and here is this invoice, and we've budgeted for, you know, 4 hours of any additional things that you might need, but payment is due net 30. Long-term projects, maybe we split it out more. But do you notice one thing about all of my splits there? Are they ever equal? Why is that? Because accounting departments are dumb. If they get 2 invoices from the same vendor for the same amount of money, even if it's got a different date and a different invoice number, we already paid this. Can't tell you how many times things got pushed aside. I have learned the hard way to never send 2 invoices for the exact same amount and put more money due up front. So as you get further and further into the project, you minimize the risk. Charge for more money up front. This way, if they start to be deadbeat, you're holding them hostage. If I've collected 85% of the money before I give them their final copy of their video, I don't feel that bad about giving them the final copy of their video, because even if they skip on me, not that I'm going to be happy, but I'm out 15%. I'm not out 100% or 50%. So get paid earlier. If you don't trust them, watermark your videos along the way. Simple little light text in the bottom corner that says, like, review copy with the date. I always spin this legitimately so. The real benefit to them is you wouldn't want somebody playing an unfinished video in front of your clients, right? This one didn't have the final narration. This one didn't go through final legal review. So these are drafts. It's important that we watermark these. Okay, the video's all approved. Not a problem. Hey, I'm getting ready to release your video to you, but just so you know, remember last week I told you that your accounting department was behind? I didn't hear back from you. I need you to go talk to accounting. We have to get your current invoices current. I'm going to send you the final invoice, but I can't release this video until you are caught up and we are current on our billing. I gave you 1 week's warning. I know you need this video for an event on Monday, and today's Wednesday. I accept credit cards. Let's get this straightened out. You are not a bank. Every one of your clients probably makes more money than you do. You are not a bank. Don't be a bank. Take credit cards if you need to. Okay? All right. And this is basically bullshit. Anybody who promises you points or percentages, tries to convince you to work on their film, very rarely does this ever make money for anybody. There are thousands upon thousands of aspiring filmmakers. The chances of them succeeding is a lot like musicians. Did you know that over 99% of all music recorded in recording studios never earns back the money it cost to record the album in the first place? In record sales. The band might make money from touring and other things, but for selling records, that just doesn't happen anymore. So don't think that you're gonna make money. Royalty-based only works for stock footage. One of my favorite stock footage companies, if you wanna start licensing your footage, is Pond5. They do a 50-50 split with the artist, which is basically unheard of in the stock community. So half of the sales price goes back to you as the creator. They're very good. They're a New York company. They're independently owned. They're not owned by Getty, who's not one of my favorite companies. I used to work with iStock and some of their stuff. This is a great way to fill out your portfolio of work and to take some of your down days and create content that you can license and sell. Or if you have shoot opportunities that come up and clients are trying to beat you up on price, see if you can't negotiate. like, oh, okay, we did some work with a nonprofit and we knew that we were going to have a scene that was a basketball court. Not a problem. Your budget's tight. After we shoot your stuff, I'm going to do an hour's worth of shooting that day with some actors that we used in the background of your video. And I'm going to shoot some stock footage of these guys playing one-on-one basketball. That's my footage and I own. Hey, we got a doctor's office secured and we're going to do this one scene. I'm going to do the same, some different footage with the same actors that I own that I can license for stock, but I'm going to wait 1 year to do anything with it. So your PSA is already run and ran, and they're going to do a wardrobe change as well. So they'll look different. Does that make sense? You can start to fit stock footage into as a strategy of your production, but just, you know, use that as a tool. Lastly, on billing, always compare things, look at the original bid, look at the budget, look at those change orders and reconcile it. I always send the final bill over to the client and say, here it is, take a look at it. This is why it's different, please approve it. Always put the client name, the project and purchase order and a due date on it and the payment terms. If you don't put an actual date, it works against you. I see people say things like net 30 and they don't put a due date. Even if there's an invoice date on it, accounting departments only look at the due date. If you want to speed up that bill, there's a couple things you can do. Here we go. So here's an example of an invoice. So name of the company, contact information, date, invoice number, full information, who your client was so that they know who to look up, payment terms, due date, description, everything here, description. Simple, but you always need that stuff on the invoice. You want to be specific. You need to actually put the word bill or invoice on it so they know that it's a bill or an invoice and not a quote or a proposal. And it just disappeared, didn't it?
Okay. You're back.
Okay. So always put those payment terms on there and make sure it's clear. Other things you can do is you can speed up the bill by a couple of things. One is discounts. So clients always push me for discounts. They want discounts. I do discounts. It depends. Repeat business, I may give a discount. Referrals, first-time projects, nonprofits. But the discount always appears as a line item on the bill. This is the real price. This is your discount. Do you know what the next line down says? Discount honored until this date, which happens to be the due date on the invoice. So if they don't pay on time, now if I have to go to collections, they owe the full amount, not the discounted amount. When they say, well, why am I being penalized? I said, look, you're not being penalized. I'm giving you my work at a lower price. The least thing you could do is pay me on time. You want a discount? Pay me on time. Take out your credit card. Pay me on time. I will let it slip a day or two. I will, you know, reach out and say, I know that this probably fell through the cracks. It's not your fault. Hey, look, I talked to accounting, and if you can get this to me by Friday, it's going to be okay. Now, some of you are going, I don't have an accounting department. I've had an accounting department from the beginning. Do you know who sends the invoices? Accounting@redpixel.com. Do you know who sends the friendly, helpful emails? Rich@redpixel.com, even if it's the same person. Have your own accounting department by having a separate email address that sends the invoices so that the painful, evil process doesn't become associated with your name. Simple, but it works. Okay? All right. Before we go forward and just talk about some client management things, and I just want to do a time check, any questions on what we talked about and how are we holding up? Yeah.
Do you have this on some kind of recorded time? 20 minutes.
20 minutes left?
Yeah.
Okay. I have some of this on lynda.com. It's not nearly as frank because I don't, when I'm recorded, I'm not quite so blunt, both because they don't like the bluntness there, and I also have to be careful of what I say in an online recording. I have some business stuff on Lynda. I have a book called Professional Web Video that breaks down some of our business approach as well to billing and strategy. And you'll be able to download these slides too. So
I didn't hear before, but you teach on lynda.com?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There was another question? Yeah.
Hi, just in general, how do you handle like unexpected expenses? Like you're supposed to shoot on a sunny day, but it rains.
Or yep.
The union comes in and says, no, you can't shoot because you need union people or whatever.
Right. Well, the union is not the client's fault. So we had union happen before. So for example, we gave the client a quote and they were shooting at the Caesars in Las Vegas. Caesars happened to be built off of a loan from the Teamsters. Caesars is the most unionized facility in Las Vegas. We had to have union people who stood next to us on the shoot who did nothing. Even though we had our own director of photography, we had to hire a union videographer who did nothing but stand next to the camera while our guy ran it. It was explained to the client, and we had suggested to the client that they select a facility for the recording that did not have union contracts. We said this is what it costs for our people to come and shoot the project. This doesn't encounter any additional facility fees or fees associated with the venue that you've selected for your production. So we were protected that way. And so when there was union fees, they had to pay for it. Because they chose to put their shoot in Caesar's Palace rather than at an adjacent hotel like we had suggested. We knew there was going to be union fees because we did our research about the location before we arrived. Sunny day and it turns to rain, you always have to have a backup plan. We will say in our things, this is our indoor shooting location. We'll shoot, you know, we always plan the outdoor shoots for first in the day. So that way, you know, and we put the indoor stuff in the afternoon. We flip it if needed. We've had projects where, you know, we had a huge budget and rain or shine, the shoot had to happen, you know. Overcast, a lot of times I have to explain to clients, I'll say two things. Overcast days are some of the best lighting on the planet. I'm okay with clouds. And usually when it rains, it only rains for a short while. The other day it poured for 30 minutes and then it stopped and it was fine. So I will always try to budget that. If it is something like TV shoots where they budget that, they budget for days that they may not shoot. They say, look, we've budgeted for 5 shooting days. We only need 3. If we don't use these other 2, they'll go away, but here it is. So you just have to have it in your contract or your agreement. It's not your fault that it rained, right? You didn't control it, you didn't order it. So therefore, it's not your problem. But you either have to, you know, clients can carry insurance. You can get insurance on productions to cover weather. Or you can have a backup indoor location, right? So that's my take. Okay. All right. So managing the project, I'm going to fly through some of this here, but I'm a big believer in project management. And the reason why is because it lets you keep control over the project. There's a lot of documentation out there in project management, but I break it down to a couple simple things when working with my clients. One of the first rules I say is don't make them ask. If my client has to question what's going on, it means you've lost their confidence. That doesn't mean that they might not ask you a question about something you've sent them for clarification or better understanding. But they have to say, well, when am I going to see the next version, or oh, when's that script coming over? If you haven't already given them that answer, it means that they're worried about you making the deadline, or you haven't, you've lost that, they've lost confidence in you because you're not communicating with them enough. I always tell my teammates, if you have a bad feeling, say something. So chances are, if something feels wrong, it's wrong. I have made a lot of money listening to my gut, knowing when something feels like it's not right, that I need to keep probing. It might just be something small, but it might be something big. The client may not even want to tell you that something's wrong. So you might have to ask, hey, is there anything that you're, you know, is there anything we could be doing better? Is there anything else I can get you for the project or that you need from me? Do you have any questions on anything I sent over? It doesn't mean that it's wrong. It could just be that they're like, oh, I really don't understand this, or oh, I sent this to my boss and I can't get their feedback and we're gonna go off deadline. Okay, well, how can I help? So you have to pick up when there's a problem. You have to make sure that the client actually knows and believes that you're on their side. The bulk of my repeat work comes from the fact that the clients feel like I understand them, that I get their project, their mission, their objectives, that I go beyond just doing the job and trying to understand why what they do is important, what's important to them. I ask them lots of questions about their business. I study it before I go in. When they come in, they're fascinated about how much I already know about them and how much I understand their business. This comes from my background as a journalist. By knowing and understanding the client, you deepen the relationship with the client. And lastly, always think about things from their point of view. This is something I've had to teach my employees a whole bunch. What I say is that's great. You're telling me that everything is under control, that we're about to deliver to the client their changes, and that we're gonna have no problem making their deadline. From their point of view though, they're freaked out because their event is 3 days away and I've gotten 2 phone calls and 6 emails asking when's the video coming over. You are a communications professional who has failed to communicate. Just always remember that the only reality that matters is the client's reality. Doesn't matter if you're right, doesn't matter if it's perfect. If they're not happy, you shouldn't be happy. It's kind of like a spouse, right? Doesn't matter even if you are ultimately right, it's not worth the fight. So simple things, but the project management process is pretty straightforward. Pick the concept, figure out who's in charge, identify what's needed. We already talked about that work breakdown structure. Figure out who you need to do the job, figure out how much time it's going to take. Build the schedule, make a budget, and just sort of run the job. The key things that people skip all the time is the work breakdown structure and the time estimation. People get hung up all the time and ask silly questions like, what's a good per minute charge for video? Said, I don't know. I've done national TV commercials that were $80,000 for 30 seconds, and I've done, meetings and events that were where we shot an entire day for $8,000. You tell me what the per minute charge is. Pretty big range there, right? There's a huge difference in quality and end product for those. That national spot at 30 seconds may take 3 days to shoot with 6 locations and multiple actors who have fees that have to get paid and licenses for how many markets it runs in and the music and everything else. So the answer to how much should it cost is what are you doing? And I know that that sounds like a cop out, but if you just define what it is you're doing, it's not hard to figure out the cost. If you can figure out how much it costs to cook a meal for your family, you can figure out how much it costs to make a video. You just have to break it down to the ingredients and the effort. Along the way, always get sign-off. Determine milestones where sign-off has to occur. Hey, we've made a treatment, a description of the project. We've given you 3 treatments. Pick one, or let's merge these or adjust until we have a description that makes sense. Okay, you've signed off on the treatment. Let's write the script. Okay, you've signed off on the script. We shoot the video. You decide after you shoot the video that you don't like the video anymore, even though we followed the script. That's a problem. You approve the script, right? We'll do things on interview-driven pieces of requiring the client to put somebody in the room with us. We say, look, you know the goals of the organization. You or an appointed representative needs to sit in the room during the interview. We'll lead the interview. We'll cover all the points you've asked, but we won't know if this person is answering it correctly. You will add value. You will best know what needs to be accomplished. And so we try to involve them in the process. We give them their own monitor. We tell them to sit back. We make it fun for them. They get their own chair. They can sit there. They can interact. They get taken care of. But they understand that they're part of the creative process. And that, we know communications, we know technical things, you know your organization best. We're going to try to learn it for you. Now, I have worked with organizations that, due to turnover, I know more about the organization than the junior assistant woodchuck I've been assigned. But sometimes we have to have that conversation very politely. Like, I understand that you want to do that, but on 5 or 6 other projects, they wanted to make sure that we didn't refer to them as diabetics, that these are people with diabetes, and we have to say that it is a person first who has something. We're not classifying by the disease. I think we should tweak this. No, I want to do it this way. Okay, well, do me a favor. I need you to sign off on the script this way, and I'm just going to put this note in here. I'm going to leave my comment in there. That's how we use track comments, so that when it goes up the chain of command and they're like, we need to re-record the voiceover. Why did you do this? I flagged it. I identified it. Here's the three pieces of communication where I asked to change it. The person insisted that this was the correct way. You have to be very careful on those things, but you have to protect yourself. Okay? All right. On the client communication, a couple things I like to say is open communication, frequent communication, and remember, perception is reality. So it goes back to that thing of thinking about it from their point of view. I always say, think about what you're saying. You know, does the client think that you're only doing the job because you need the work? I want my clients to feel that I'm passionate about doing certain types of video. I love doing video for fundraising, cause-oriented, altruistic groups. I'm passionate about helping other people who want to change the world and make it better. Let me show you some of the projects I've worked on. I love doing this stuff. I love producing educational content. I think that education should be highly accessible. They believe that you are in it for the same reasons they are, and you just get paid fairly. So you have to think about that. So that's why I try to position ourselves as helping them. You know, this happens a lot. People who push a concept, people who are experts, trust me, I know what I'm doing. They tell you just to do it one way because they're the expert. They don't want to explain. Don't question. These are not the droids you're looking for. They just, you know, this doesn't work. Clients don't want to be told what to do. They don't want you to fight with them. Now, in my company, I will play good cop, bad cop. I will purposely, when the producer is struggling or the client's being difficult, I'll pick up the phone and say, hey, look, you know, we're trying to hash this out. Let me explain why we're trying to do this. And this is why we're pushing you to say it this way or do it this way. Now, you tell me why you want to do it the other way. Okay, I better understand you. Let me refine the approach, but can you think about the things I gave you? And I'm going to send over a new version for your reaction. I'll fight. I don't let my employees fight. You know, I'm the one who can take it. And pretty simple. I tell our clients all the time that I manipulate them for their own best interest. Just like I manipulate their audience for their interest. I say, look, we produce strategic communications. We produce video. When's the last time you watched a TV show or a movie that you didn't have an emotional reaction? Whether you laughed or you cried or you got angry. So that's good content. If you didn't feel something, it didn't work. So I tell people all the time, our goal is to manipulate the audience. So yes, we are going to try to make them cry during a fundraising piece. We're going to try to make them laugh during an educational piece and feel challenged in a good way. So you have to think that through. Clients call me when they have problems, even if it's stuff that's not directly associated with their project. And we help them find things. We'll tell people, call us when you're trying to put your strategy together for next year. You want to talk about trends? We hold open houses, teach them about things like how to better use YouTube and social media. Why? Well, it makes them better at their job. And they see us as a resource, and when they need content like photos and video for that stuff, they hire us. But we teach them stuff, even stuff we don't do, if it fits into a bigger picture. So when you do this, they see you as a long-term partner. Okay? So it's pretty important. Other things I would say as you're putting the project together, yeah, 5 minutes, yep. One thing that I recommend is pretty simple. It's called the control cycle. So what you can do is mark out all of the steps in a video project. You'll see ours when you download these slides, but it identifies every major step along the way. And then it gets checked off when it gets completed. You'll be able to download this, so don't worry about photographing it. Okay, so this will help let you know like you've done everything. It's amazing how often you skip a step. And you'll see when things like reviews are called out. These are milestone moments where internal or external reviews happen. I gotta tell you, one of the things I've learned is that there are always people more talented than you, but if you can be business savvy, as many of you know, since you belong to a professional business group, that is what drives repeat business. People go back to people that they trust. So I find that when I put this all together, just to sort of wrap this part up, a couple pieces of parting advice. The first one comes to sort of keeping the clients happy. So one of the things we've learned is that by keeping that open communication with frequent communication, it leads to repeat business. Consider positioning yourself as a strategic communications consultant or a storyteller. Decide what your role is. But video is no different than photography. You're capturing images of stuff. What's different is if you think like a photographer, you often think of montage. But if you've ever done editorial or magazine photography or annual report where you had to think about covering things with multiple shots to tell a more complete story, you can think about that for video. A great book, there's tons of books out there on video. Focal Press publishes a lot of books on filmmaking. You know, it's not hard to find. The Visual Story by Bruce Block is a great film school book. He teaches at UCLA, the other one, USC. And basically, it's film school in a book. He says, watch this movie and now read this chapter. And it's film school. It's like a 2-year films course in one book. It will help you start to think about the art form of video and understand it. But there's not that much of a difference between photography and video. The differences are you have to think about how the pieces fit together and you have to work collaboratively. All right. Beyond this, with keeping the clients happy, always have value-added services. You know, before our clients asked for video for the web, we gave them video for the web. Now we do things like give them behind-the-scenes photos and extra stills that they can use for social media. Here's some stuff about your project. Hey, by the way, we saved off the background in your animated logo so you can use it in your PowerPoint presentation. Think about things you can do that just make them happier with you that really don't cost you anything. We make sure that we get stuff back. We try to do debriefs. Little simple things, when we enter awards, we get a copy for the client. Every award we ever win, list our name and their name as the creator, and then they get a copy. So if we win a trophy, they win a trophy. And we send a personal thank you note at the end of every project, signed by every single team member. A handwritten thank you note gets delivered, thanking them for the job, and everyone who worked on the job signs it. It's amazing when they think of you as a human and other humans, how much better they treat you than when they stop thinking of you as a company. So again, that comes back to thinking about it from their point of view. So think of it this way. You want them to see you as a trustworthy person. Yes, you are a string puller. As photographers and video people, we manipulate reality. We choose what to show and what not to show. Your job is to motivate people to take action. Fight, but fight for your client. Don't fight against them, fight for them. Make them feel like you're on their side. You understand their business. You want to know after the video was done. You follow up 2 months or 3 months later. How's it working for you? Did you get any extra feedback once you deployed it in the field? For example, that PSA that we recently did, when we followed back up with the client, they're like, this is phenomenal. Half of all new business coming in through our website is citing the TV commercial as how they heard about us. Great. What do you need from us for the next one? Oh, well, I need this and this. Okay, and do you guys have experience in doing stuff in Spanish? Yeah, we can produce spots in English and Spanish, no problem. Great, because the next one's bilingual. Okay, great. Boom, next project came in, didn't have to bid, didn't have to do anything other than the work. We're getting ready to do the third one. It's perfect. By simply following up and showing that you care, it works. Don't make them think less of you. This comes back to the point of view. And make them feel like they can call you when they need you. All of our staff members who are directly client-facing have to put their cell phone on there. I tell clients, look, if it's the dinner hour, I'm probably not answering. There are certain times a day I won't answer, but I will get back to you within 4 hours. I don't care if it's weekends or evenings. I will get back to you within 4 hours unless I'm asleep. And if they feel that they can reach out to you, it works great. Clients knowing that they can reach you on the weekends goes a long way. All right. So the final advice is this. Things I've learned the hard way. There's always somebody out there who will do the work for less than you. Never compete on price. You will never win. There is always somebody out there who is more talented than you. I see this all the time. I've written the books. I have taught people how to be better than me. I teach people everything I know about technical skills, and they have more artistic vision. They make stuff better than I can make it. And there's always people who are going to be better at something. But what it comes down to is nobody is like you. And when the clients are choosing to work with you, it's for the whole package. Not the button pushing, not the photos. It's what they get in the end. And so I always tell people this. Ultimately, in today's economy, it's easy to find somebody who pushes buttons. Push buttons to make photos, push buttons to make websites, push buttons to make videos. There are millions upon millions of button pushers being churned out who watch online education, free content, content that I produce for free, steal content, creative live, schools, programs. There's no shortage of this. But ultimately, the people who hire you because they like and respect you. They can hire anybody, but they like and respect you. Doesn't mean they love you. But they feel like you're a good person to work with, you're fair in your pricing, you care about them, and you always do the right thing for them. If you take that as the business ethics approach, the work will come. So as you add video into your workflow, you are going to be able to be fine with your clients as you say to them, look, let's work together on this. You know, I've done stills with you for years. I understand you. You need a video, not a problem. Product shots, let's do that. Let's add motion and turntables. Let's capture some interviews with the team and make some vignettes for your website. Start simple. Get the simple projects. I didn't get the national TV commercials for the Red Cross by saying, give me your national TV commercials. I got them by doing things like working on the lifeguarding and the health and safety videos, and they knew me and they trusted me. And when it came time for the big September 11th campaigns, we got them. Because not of what we did, but because of who we were. People will hire you and let you do things that they don't have full confidence in you if they trust you and they know that you're going to be fair. So that's the parting advice. If you need to grab a card, do it. I hope this gives you some insight into the world of video and how to think about it and maybe challenges some of your status quo on business practices, but I hope it helps. Not all of it will work, but it's what I recommend. Thank you.